Good morning.
Good morning.
It's great to see you all this morning. Along with that welcome, I have one main announcement. It's Palm Sunday, which means we're going into Holy Week, right? So for Holy Week, we have a good, the Monday-Thursday service at Montgomery. So if you want to join us at 7 p.m. at First Presbyterian Church in Montgomery at 7 p.m. for the Monday-Thursday service. And then here for Good Friday at 7 p.m. And then there'll be a sunrise service, 6:15. That's what I have down, right? The sunrise here with breakfast to follow. We're inviting folk from Montgomery to come over here for breakfast. So if you want to come and for the morning sunrise service, stay for some breakfast. Then we'll have worship at 9:30. Well, there are announcements. Let us prepare our hearts and minds for worship with a moment of silence. Friends, I invite you to stand as you are able as we respond to God's call to worship this morning. You may not see it,
but the air is full of exciting energy.
You may not notice it,
but something is stirring that cannot be contained.
You may not recognize it,
but it nestles deep within each one of us.
And within this community,
our life changes.
Let us sing together hymn number 88. God of something new, Every year we purchase palm branches, waving them with one hand while holding hymns in the other. We sing, sometimes we shout, Hosanna, and we imagine Jesus riding on the back of the donkey as we try to get him to see this strange parade. We long for something new, and you surprise us with something unexpected. You offer us the radical approach to life, but we aren't sure we trust your way of doing things. Help us see your perfect vision for creation, and help us find the courage to strive for it, so that we may be a lasting ray of hope in the world, even now, as we offer our son.
I invite you to a moment of silent personal confession. Friends, hear this good news. In Jesus Christ, we are waving branches and sounding Hosanna to him as he comes into the city. It is that Christ who offers us freedom, forgiveness, for all that we may have done. In Christ's name, know this. We are all forgiven. Thanks be to God. You may be seated. One note, I have a sticky note here as a reminder, and I missed it. You have attendance pads in your pews, hopefully, nearby. If you want to let us know you're here, write down your name and let us know that you're here this morning. We'll use that to track our attendance. Friends, as we are doing that and we prepare our hearts and minds to hear our scripture passages and message, let us go to God in a prayer of illumination. Gracious and loving God, we ask you for your spirit upon us as we seek to hear and understand your word. Your words revealed to us in pages of scripture, in the message today, in the words of song, in whatever way you decide is fitting to reveal it to us. Use those words to mold and shape us in your disciples and guide us in our lives. We ask for all this in the name of our rock and our redeemer, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen.
Our first passage this morning will come from Psalm 118, verses 1 and 2, and 19 through 29. Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His steadfast love endures forever. Let Israel say, his steadfast love endures forever. Open to me the gates of righteousness, that I may enter through them and give thanks to the Lord. This is the gate of the Lord. The righteous shall enter through it. I thank you that you have answered me and have become my salvation. The stone that the builders rejected has become the chief cornerstone. This is the Lord's doing. It's marvelous in our eyes. This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Save us, we beseech you, O Lord. O Lord, we beseech you, give us success. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. We bless you from the house of the Lord. The Lord is God, and he has given us light. Bind the festival processions with branches up to the horn of the altar. You are my God, and I will give thanks to you. You are my God. I will extol you. Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good, and his steadfast love endures forever. Our second passage this morning will come from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 19, verses 28 through 40. Let's hear this gospel message. After Jesus had said this, he went on ahead, going up to Jerusalem. When he had come near Bethphage and Bethany, at the place called the Mount of Olives, he sent two of his disciples, saying, "Go into the village ahead of you, and as you enter it, you will find tied there a colt that has never been ridden. Untie it and bring it here. If anyone asks you, 'Why are you untying it?' just say this, 'The Lord needs it.'" So those who were sent departed and found it as he had told them. As they were untying the colt, the owners asked them, "Why are you untying this colt?" And they said, "The Lord needs it." Then they brought it to Jesus, and after throwing their cloaks on it, they set Jesus upon it. As he rode along, the people kept spreading their cloaks on the road, as he was now approaching the path down the Mount of Olives. The whole multitude of the disciples began to praise God joyfully with a loud voice for all the deeds of the disciples, for all the deeds and the power they had seen him, saying, "Blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord. Peace in heaven and glory in the highest heaven." Some of the Pharisees in the crowd said to him, "Teacher, order your disciples to stop." But he answered them, "I tell you, these were silent. The stones would shout out." Friends, this is the word of the Lord. So this morning's lectionary passage tied to this image of Palm Sunday, right? Doesn't fit some of the amalgamated stories we tell, the donkey and the palms. Neither of those appear here, right? You have the colt and you have coats laid down. So I guess if you had your coat, you could wave it around. But we get the point, right? Jesus rode in on a colt or a donkey, and they waved branches and laid their garments down to make a moment of praise. In this moment, this morning's reading describes that triumphal entry of Jesus into Jerusalem, which happened at the beginning of this week. Some say right around maybe 30 AD. I don't think the date exactly matters that much, but people argue. But in this moment, you have a true moment filled with, in our imagery, right? Palms and passion. This moment is a different type of passion. Right? I had somebody ask me the other day, I grew up all the time, and they would have this Sunday called Passion Sunday. Anybody familiar, ever had that, seen that? So palms is the moment of this triumphal entry. The passion part is death. So this moment is a different type of passion. Right? It's one of emotion and energy and worship and exhilaration of what that's taking place and being part of it. And this is the beginning where we mark this entry into the holiest of week, right? Holy week for us. We have this moment when Jesus decided to go into Jerusalem, even though it was absolutely a dangerous place for him. He was going in, Jesus said to his disciples, "Go to that next village, right? Go up and you're going to find that colt there. I want you to take it and bring it back to me, so I can ride into the city." We might not think that what he rides is important, but it is. Everything Jesus does is important in this moment because he lives out an opposite life from what everybody expects. They expect Jesus to ride in this mighty horse with an army behind him, right? Tying back to this revolt that happened hundreds of years earlier, where the previous leader had run out all the
talk about this violence and force. And that, hey, this Messiah, Jesus, is going to do this again. We're ready for him. So for most of those people, when they're shouting Hosanna and waving those palm branches and throwing down their coat, they're picturing something else coming from Jesus. They expect Jesus to ride up to the Roman and powerful authorities and just run them out. Somebody remember where Jesus actually went? He went to the temple. And instead of causing conflict and problems for the Roman power, he causes some conflict within his own church. Saying, what are you doing? We're not living the right way. What was my Father's house made for? Jesus lives out something totally different than anybody expected, and frankly, probably different than anybody wanted. That's the moment we move into Holy Week. We move into this moment of Jesus' triumphal entry. In this week ahead of us, we're going to move through a time where we talk about Maundy Thursday, right? This moment when Jesus was preparing for what he knew was coming. Yes, he shared a meal. But he also got down on his hands and feet as the Messiah and washed his disciples and prepared them for what would come to them. That moment is all of Maundy Thursday. He spent a week telling them and showing them what leadership in God's kingdom actually looked like. Okay? I didn't come in with a mighty army, and now I'm on my hands and feet cleaning, hands and knees cleaning your feet. I am not the leader you expect. And then we're going to move to the real moment of passion, right? We're going to move through Good Friday. The part we can't remember, that a lot of my friends who are Christians don't really like to talk about that day, right? But this week is probably one of the most significant weeks that's happened in the Christian history of humanity. Probably tied to there with Jesus' birth, right? I mean, but this is an extremely significant week in the history of the world. I imagine there have been more things written about this week than any other week in the history of humanity. It's a defining moment in our lives, even if you're not a Christian. Right? That week impacted you in some way, shape, or form. Even the people who say, I don't believe in anything, they're out searching for Easter eggs with their kids, not because what else, right? It does have connections back to this week. There's reasons that this week is significant and important. And who Jesus is and why he is. There's a reading from this writing of One Solitary Life, and I want to share it. I like the way it talks about who Jesus is and his importance in the world. Here's what they wrote. He was born in an obscure village, child of a peasant woman. He grew up in a still, another village, where he worked as a carpenter in the carpenter's shop until he was about 30. Then for only 3 years, he was an itinerant preacher. He never wrote a book. He never held an actual office. He never had a family, and I would add there, he never had his own married family. Everybody has a family. He never owned a house. He did not go to college. He never really visited a big city. Never traveled beyond 200 miles from where he was born. He never did any of the things that our society ties to greatness. Not a single one of them. He had no credentials but himself. He was only 33 years of age when the tide of public opinion turned against him. His friends ran away. He was turned over to his enemies, went through the mockery of a trial. He was nailed to a cross between two thieves. While he was dying, his executioners gambled for his clothing, the only property he had on this earth. When he was dead, he was laid in a borrowed grave for the pity of a friend. Friends, 19 centuries have come and gone, and today, this person remains a central figure to the human race. And leader of mankind's progress. They go on to write, put together none of the armies, they wrote, all the armies have never marched, that have ever marched, all the navies that have ever sailed, all the parliaments that have ever sat, all the kings that have ever reigned, put together, have not affected the life of man on this planet as much as that one solitary life. That's why it's special and unique. And that's why this week is special and unique, because it is the last week of that life on this earth in human form. This week of his death and resurrection. It is a week that we move towards this incredibly important moment of Good Friday. That recognition that we need somebody to help us with our sin and make us well. That reality that, right, this is the hardest thing I've ever had to come to terms with in my life, that our sins, my sins, contributed to the reality that Jesus needed to die. Right? And I would love to say we've progressed a long ways, but right, we probably still live in a world, if you have some 30-something-year-old kid show up and want to change the world, he might not survive it. We still live in those places. This moment of palms and passion. So I spent some time yesterday, and so if I seem out of the time today, I apologize, but all day yesterday I was with the Honor Club. Went to D.C., spent a great amount of time with some of our veterans. Couldn't help but think about today a little bit as I was doing that. Here's people who have answered a call to serve, who have done so valiantly and lost friends and suffered in the course of it. And I thought back, I wonder what our world would have been like if we would actually listened to that 30-something-year-old kid that asked us to usher in a whole new kingdom. While I give thanks for all of the 81 veterans that served we were with, none of them would have had to do it if we would have listened, right? We talked about the 405,000 people or so that were represented by the stars in the World War II monument. We wouldn't have had any of those there, right? If we would have actually been waving those palms for the right reason. So as we wave these palms today, as you take them home, as I saw someone already holding a palm cross, something I'm going to do later today with my daughter. As you do that, remember what Jesus is asking us to do. To become something totally, radically new and different, to set aside the things the world tells us we should be doing. And become something new. Become something different. Create a world of peace and justice and mercy and love and kindness. To live in that space.
So with that, I invite you into this holiest of weeks to remember this last week in Jesus' life and all that he endured and went through on our behalf. Thanks be to God, and amen. I invite you to join me in singing hymn number 91. Right on. Before we jump into our shared joys and serves, we have one of the earlier of it, a joy. We needed to do some installation ordinations that some people weren't here last time. So we need if Betty, if you want to join us up here, and Louise, is she here? No. So Betty Moorhead, if you want to join us, and then I'll need Lee, if you want to join us at the clearance. Well, install you. You're already ordained as a deacon, so we're going to install you as a deacon. So. Just come join me over here. Friends, we are called into the Christ, Jesus Christ Church by our baptism. By God's Spirit. In this common calling to be a disciple and servant of our Lord within this community, right, for the larger work of God's world. We are called as deacons, elders, ministers of word and sacrament, but all of us are continuing God's ministry, providing for the ministries of care and compassion in the world, offering governance, ordering of governance for the church, and preaching of the word and sacraments. I'll hand this over to Lee.
Representing the one holy Catholic and apostolic church, the session of Hopewell Presbyterian Church now ordains Betty Moorhead to the office of deacon and installs her to active service. That's it, right?
Yep, active service in the church. So she's impromptu reading off my script. So. And you've already been ordained, right?
Yes.
All
Right, that's what I had down. I want to make sure.
Friends, the service of this church, the whole church, in these moments, I always ask people to renew their commitments, right? To remind us of our baptism, that we take this on gladly with God's calling. Therefore, let us reaffirm our baptismal vows, renouncing all that opposes God and God's rule, affirming the faith of the Holy Catholic Church. So, trusting in God's gracious mercy, do you turn from ways of sin and renounce evil and its power in the world? Do you?
Yes.
Do you turn to Jesus Christ and accept Him as your Lord and Savior, trusting in His grace and love? Do you?
I do.
Will you be God, Christ's faithful disciple, obeying His word and showing His love? Will you? Friends, let us go to God in a prayer of thanksgiving. Eternal and gracious God, we give you thanks. In countless ways you have revealed yourself in ages past. You have blessed us with signs of your grace, and we praise you that through the waters of the sea you led your people of Israel out of bondage into freedom of a promised land. We praise you for sending your Son, Jesus Christ, who was baptized in the waters of the Jordan and was anointed as Christ by your Holy Spirit. Through the baptism of his death and resurrection, you set us free from the bondage of sin and death and give us cleansing and rebirth. We praise you that in baptism you give us your Holy Spirit, who teaches us and leads us in all truth, fulfilling us with a variety of gifts, that we might proclaim the gospel to all nations, to serve you as a royal priesthood. We rejoice that you have claimed us in our baptism, and that by your grace we are born anew. And by your Holy Spirit, we ask that you renew us, that we might be empowered to do your will and continue forever in the risen life of Christ, to whom, with you and the Holy Spirit, be all glory and honor for now and forever. Amen. You've already answered these questions, but I always ask people to be reminded of them. So here are the constitutional questions. Do you trust Jesus Christ, your Savior, acknowledge Him Lord of all and head of the church, and through Him believe in one God, Father, and Holy Spirit? Do you accept the Scriptures of the Old and New Testament to be, by the Holy Spirit, the unique and authoritative witness to the church, Jesus Christ and the Church Universal, and God's Word to you? Do you sincerely receive and adopt the essential tenets of the Reformed faith as expressed in the confessions of our church as authentic and reliable expositions of what Scripture leads us to believe and do? And will you be instructed and led by those confessions as you lead the people of God? Will you fulfill this office in obedience to Jesus Christ under authority of Scripture and be continually guided by our confessions? Will you be governed by our church's polity, and will you abide by its discipline? Will you be a friend among your colleagues in ministry, working with them, subject to the ordering of God's word and spirit? Will in your own life you seek to follow our Lord Jesus Christ, to love your neighbors, and to work for the reconciliation of the world? Do you promise to further the peace, unity, and purity of the church? Do you? And will you seek to serve the people with all the energy and intelligence and imagination and love you can muster? Will you? So as a deacon, will you be a faithful deacon, teaching charity, urging concern, and directing the people's help to the friendless and those in need? And in your ministry, will you try to show the love and justice of Jesus Christ? Will you? So this is for everyone here. And if you want to read the question.
Do we, the members of the church, accept Betty Moorhead as a deacon chosen by God through the voice of this congregation in the way of Jesus Christ?
We do.
Do we agree to encourage her, to respect her decisions, and to follow as they guide us, serving Jesus Christ, who alone is the head of the church?
We do.
She's already ordained. So let us go to God in prayer of installation. Gracious and loving God, we ask you pour your spirit upon Betty as she answers that calling to serve you in this office of deacon. we here at Hopewell Presbyterian Church have installed her as your leader in the church to live out your love and compassion. And we ask that you pour out all of the gifts that she will need to do this work, to serve you through all of us. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Friends, your newest installed deacon. Well, that's a good segment into our joys, right? Anybody ever answers God's call to serve the church? No other prayers? Let's go with God in prayer. Gracious, loving God, first and foremost, we come to you in prayer to say thank you, thank you, thank you. Thank you for the gift of everything we have been given in life. Thank you for those you have called from within this family of faith to serve you on behalf of this congregation. We give thanks for moments with family. We give thanks for a new stove. We give thanks for the gift of your rain, though we sometimes won't want as much. We give thanks for those who are healing after trials with health. We give thanks that Rita is doing well, that she has a place where people are caring for her. We also come to you in prayer for those who are in need, for those who find themselves with health challenges. We lift them up. We lift up Suzanne and Bob this week, especially Suzanne works to take care of her husband and also help take care of us. We lift up those in Ukraine who know the reality of violence and death that most of us can't even imagine. We ask you to be with them. And we ask that you move in the hearts and minds of all those in our world who would like to live out violence to others. Stop them. Move them to know war no more. We also ask you to hear us as we come to you in a common voice and a common prayer, as Jesus taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, let us enjoy the gift of some special music this morning. Thank you.
For our moment before we sing our doxology together, I want to talk a little bit about our one great hour of sharing. So you'll see these where you pick up your bulletins. There's some envelopes out there where you could offer if you would like. So one great hour of sharing is the largest offering that our denomination takes up. It goes to help those in need, right? Connects to that idea that we should help those who are the least. That's what it lives out in every way that we can. The three programs that it goes to fund are the Presbyterian Hunger Program, that have done things like give grants to local pantries that are run. Especially during the pandemic, a lot of money came out of our denomination to go wherever people requested to go. And the self-development of people, it's not just a program, right, that just says, hey, we're going to give you money and you do your own stuff, or we're going to come in and do it for you. They find programs that people have developed to help themselves, and they fund them. One of the programs I had the gift of seeing was in New York City, where they had Filipino refugees that were escaping violence and often human trafficking. Where they had developed a company that would hire them to work, that would also give them legal assistance to get them help to become citizens and do that work. And it was all ran by fellow Filipino immigrants, or I should say people who were trafficked, who fought for freedom. And we gave money from this to help them do their work, right? And then, of course, Presbyterian Disaster Assistance. If you've ever heard of any disaster in the world, odds are they're there. This is the organization that funnels all the money that Presbyterians might want to give to help in places like Ukraine. This is the organization that does that work for us. And whether you think one little bit doesn't matter, it does. All our small offerings get combined to make us able to contribute millions when in need. So I invite you during this season, as we move into Easter, if you are so moved, to give to that special offering, as well as giving your wholeness, your whole being, to God's work in this world. Let us sing our doxology together this morning. Sing together hymn 89. Thank you. Holy Spirit, guide you, sustain you, be with you. Now,